Let's take a look at storage and data technologies and some of the cool things that we've got coming when it comes to storage medium. So first, if you take a look at storage, we've got a number of different services: disk storage, object storage, backup services, data transport for import and export out of the public cloud, hybrid storage services that let you replicate data into the public cloud or extend on-premises storage deployments into public cloud, as well as storage technologies we're working on. This whole broad suite. The majority of our storage services are all built on top of the same common infrastructure. A common storage stack that consists of three layers: a front end, a partition layer that keeps track of the partitions and where they're located, and then the stream layer, which actually stores the different extents or actual data that consists of underneath files or blobs. You can see on top, there's REST APIs for Azure Data Lake storage, for blob APIs, for file APIs, for table and queue APIs. We also have support for NFS and SMB APIs on top as well. So all of this, again, built on top of the same stack. And what that means is that you get the same kinds of scalability out of all these APIs. You get the same data replication and durability out of all these. You get the same kind of tiering from hot storage in SSDs down to cool storage in hard disks down to cold storage that might be on tapes very efficient storage spinning media services. On top, we've got replication and cluster groups that support interstamp replication. And we also have disaster recovery replication through going across regions, and object level replication as well, something we recently introduced into Azure Storage. So all of these kinds of technologies allow us to get to amazing scale with consistent kinds of capabilities across all of these different APIs. But when it comes to storage in the public cloud has really kind of unlocked the realm of storing basically infinite amounts of data. And data storage is becoming a bigger and bigger problem, something that not even the current public cloud might be able to keep up with. If we take a look at the installed capacity that we foresee as cloud storage expands with more and more hyperscale public cloud regions, with more efficient and high density storage technologies, you can see this trend line here plotted out to 2025. But if we take a look, and this is from IDC, the digital universe, meaning all the data that's consumed, not necessarily all the data that needs to be stored, but all of the data, log files, temporary files, intermediate files in generation of transmission of data from one place to another, it vastly exceeds the storage capacity that we're putting online. Not that all of that needs to be stored, but you can see that the gap continues to widen. And that means that there are some types of data that simply we won't be able to efficiently store with today's technologies. The amount of data being generated is really escaping our grasp. So this is where we're exploring novel ways to store data and very efficiently and very high scale to close this gap and even eliminate it. And one of the ways that we're doing it is by leveraging or exploring the use of DNA. DNA offers amazing promise in terms of scalability. So with DNA storage, we can take what would have been something requiring, an exabyte of data that would require data centers the size of two Walmart superstores and store it in 1 cubic centimeter of space. And not just that, but it's incredibly durable. It's sustainable, it's organic, and it's durable. It lasts hundreds of thousands to millions of years. In fact, we found on Earth 700,000-year-old biologic DNA. So stored under the right conditions, it can survive virtually forever. Now, the way that we're leveraging this is we take the nucleotides, the cytosine, guanine, adenine, and thymine, and use each one of those to encode a couple bits of information. So four of these nucleotides, and we've got four combinations here. And we encode data using gene sequencing or gene synthesis. So we synthesize these DNA molecules with the right sequence of the nucleotides And now we have created some DNA to store this. Now, you might be saying, okay, so you know, when I archive through DNA my family photos or my photos from my last vacation, what kind of creature is that going to create? Well, fortunately, these things are going to be inert and not actually grow, so we don't have to worry about weird creatures based off of your holiday photos walking around and attacking people. But the way that you read this back is just the gene sequencing part. So synthesizing to sequencing the same way that we do today with all of the gene sequencing services that are out there to decode these back into the nucleotides and transfer them back into binary bits. Here in that little pink smear on that end of that tip of that tube, that is 10 terabytes of DNA. So this kind of gives you a visceral look at the kind of scale that I was referring to earlier when I talked about exabyte and a cubic centimeter. We've not just been exploring this, we've actually gotten to the point where we've got the first fully automated DNA storage system. So it's not just, so it's showing through a proof of concept that we can actually do this end to end. And if we take a look inside of this machine, you can see the synthesis part here. This is where we'll take the binary data and synthesize the DNA molecule. We've got the storage and prep part here, where you can see inside that vial the DNA. And then we can sequence it out and get the resulting data all in one test bed. So this is kind of the next step in showing that this technology really is viable. And there's, of course, incredibly hard engineering problems to solve to make this scale and really be cost efficient, but we're well on our way down this path. So another storage medium we've been exploring is holographic storage. You might be saying, holographic storage, I might have heard of something like that. It's actually been around for a really long time. It was invented in the 1960s, but it's never been successfully commercialized. And we actually believe that now is the right time to leverage this as a cool storage technology. We also believe Microsoft is in the best position to do so because we've been working on optical technologies in this area for many years. For example, HoloLens and the optical technologies inside of it are something that we can leverage for a holographic storage. But why is it now the time? Well, there's two reasons. One, hard disk capacities continue to increase at 10x the rate that you can read them. So in other words, hard disks, while they seem to be constant speed, are actually slowing down in terms of IOPS per terabyte. And that means that it's going to be very inefficient over time to store large amounts of data inside of a hard disk and read it out efficiently. It's also the right time now because if we take a look at the kinds of technologies required to very efficiently implement holographic storage, we need very high resolution cameras. And if you take a look at the cameras coming out of commodity smartphones today, they're up at the resolutions that we need in the tens of megapixels ranges that we need to commercialize a technology like this. So problem, potential solution in the area of the storage technologies, and and we've actually made some really great progress that I'm excited to share with you here. One is that the world leading density of 1.x previously reported at holographic storage densities is something that we've been able to achieve, and we've been able to read and write with no mechanical seeks to unlock access rates that are comparable to hard disks. And we've also been able to leverage software computation via deep learning to be able to read out with high degrees of accuracy the data that's been stored in holographic storage. So we've got proof of concepts now, and the way that this works, if you take a look at this video here, so here you can see I've got these green lasers, and I've encoded the data in a 2D image here, which has one beam projecting that 2D image, another beam, which is a reference beam, intersecting that, and that being reflected into the holographic crystal, which is lithium niobate. And wherever that data intersects, what we get is excited iron atoms. So if we take a look inside of the molecular structure of that holographic crystal, wherever the reference beam and the 2D data beam intersect, that you can see there in those green lines, that those iron molecules get excited up into the conduction band. And then when the energy is released, they drop down into the valence band. And so now we've got our light pattern, which is considered a 1, and our dark patterns, which you can consider a 0, and that's the way we store data. And we can do it three-dimensionally by targeting where the beams intersect inside the crystal. And that's the way we can store high-density information inside that crystal. And then to read it out, we simply shine the reference beam back through and then take a look at the high-resolution image captured and extract the 2D image back. Now to erase, what we simply do is send a beam through that excites the iron back up into the conduction band, and then they drop back down into the steady state when done. So this is reusable media as well. And what I want to do now is show you holographic storage in action with, I think, a very cool demo, which is going to show you end to end. And here you can see on the top, what I'm going to take is a zero day and drop that in the input folder. Now what's going to happen here, and this is the error correction encoding is going to happen on top of those, that image. It's going to be split over multiple holographic images actually. And here we can see there in the lab, each of those images is being flashed into the crystal with the intersection of the reference beam and those 2D images. Now I'm going to read it out, and you can see each of those images being read out with a flash of reference beam light. Here are the resulting images. Now are going to be decoded and merged. And what comes out the other side in that output folder is zero day. And if you haven't read zero day, I recommend you go read it now. Well, that's a quick look in there. There's our erase pattern with ultraviolet light, erasing, exciting those iron atoms up into the conduction band and then dropping down into their base states. And now the crystal's ready to be used again. So that's a look at some of the very cool, exciting holographic storage progress we've been making.